So join me in the book of Joshua, once again, chapter number 14. And let's see what kind of intelligence we can pull from the text in Joshua 14. And I want to begin reading at verse number 6. Not a lot of reading, but I believe that this is strategic for each of us. Beginning at verse number 6, Joshua 14, verse 6. Then the children of Judah came unto Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said unto him, Thou knowest the thing that the Lord said unto Moses, the man of God, concerning me and thee in Kadesh Barnea. 40 years old was I when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to espy out the land. And I brought him word again, and it was in mine heart. Verse 8, Nevertheless, my brethren that went up with me made the heart of the people melt. But I wholly followed the Lord my God. And Moses swore on that day, saying, Surely the land whereon thy feet have trodden shall be thine inheritance, and thy children's forever, because thou hast wholly followed the Lord my God. Verse 10, And now behold, the Lord hath kept me alive. That is, I promise, I could stop right there, and that could be the whole message. The Lord has kept me alive. And he's, as he said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word unto Moses while the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness, and now, lo, I am this day 85 years old. I am 85. As yet I am as strong this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, even so my strength is now for war, both to go out and to come in. Verse 12, Now therefore give me this mountain whereof the Lord spake in that day. For thou heardest in that day how the Anakims were there, and that the cities were great and fenced. If so be the Lord will be with me, then I shall be able to drive them out, as the Lord has said. Let me read one more verse. I don't know if they have this logged in yet, but and Joshua blessed him. That's all I want to read. And Joshua blessed him. Just for a few moments. Again, we've been in this series called The Conqueror's Guide, and I want to speak to you today from the subject, I Can Still Do It. I can still do it. Do me a favor, just put that in the comment section, I can still do it. I can still do it. This particular pericope that we're reading from today, I believe is strategic in that God has been giving us instruction about conquering. He's been giving us instruction about taking the cities. He's talked to us about conquering our connections. He's talked to us about maintaining our sanctification. He's talked to us about making sure that we don't have any Achans in our midst, as it were, that would cause us to fall into a place of defeat where God has commanded that we conquer. We've been in this series, and in this series, there are several things that I believe the Lord has unpacked for us. But today, I want to talk about this man named Caleb. Caleb is one of the two elder people who were able to survive the wilderness. There was a whole generation of people who the Lord commanded would expire in the wilderness because of their lack of faith. But Joshua and Caleb were the only two people over the age of 20 that had the ability to be sustained in the wilderness and to cross over into the land of promise. This man, Caleb, is a very, very significant man in that it was his faith in God's promise And it was his confidence in God's ability to bring him both through and out of the wilderness into the place that God had promised that gave him the confidence to walk through the space that we're currently in today. The Bible tells us very clearly that it has been 45 years since Caleb was one of the 12 spies that left out of Kadesh Barnea and came into Canaan to spy out the land and to bring the tidings of all that had occurred within the context of the scripture there. And I want, if you will, just for a moment, I want to give us a little bit of a backstory today, because to really understand the full context of this particular text, you have to look at the entire story of Caleb. So if you wouldn't mind, just go with me very, very quickly. I don't want to belabor the point, but I believe that this is important for us. So go with me to the book of Numbers, chapter number 13. And it is here in the book of Numbers where the Bible talks about God giving Moses instruction to really send out spies into the land. And the Bible, again, begins to unpack for us certain truths about Joshua, Caleb, and the other 10 spies who went out and came back after 40 days of being in the promised land to understand everything that was happening in the land, to get a lay of the land, to understand what was happening with the cities, to understand the constituency of Canaan, to understand the kind of armies and soldiers that were there. And the Bible says that when they came back, they came back with this testimony that I believe is strategically important for us to understand the context of Caleb in Joshua chapter number 14. So here it is in Numbers 13. Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says that the children of Israel, now that these 12 spies come back from spending time in the promised land. And when they come back, the Bible says that there were 10 of those spies who had an evil report, even though they came back with the truth of what God said. So they talked about the fact that the land does flow with milk and honey. They talked about the fact that the land does have evidence, and they actually came back bringing a cluster of grapes that had to be carried between two men. So you can understand the size of these grapes. That is evidence that this is really a land that flows with milk and honey. But when they came back with the proof that God didn't lie about the land, they came back with the testimony about the inhabitants of the land, and in particular, they talked about the sons of Anak, or the children of Anak, who were giants. So that they were scared when they looked at the size of the enemy, not the numbers of the enemy, but the size of the enemy, and they started to instill fear in the people. But in verse number 30, the Bible says, and Caleb still the people before Moses, listen to this, and said, let us go up at once and possess it. One more time. You had 10 who were talking about, we're too afraid to go. There are giants in the land. There's no way we can defeat them. But Caleb stilled the people. Fear was starting to grab a hold to the leaders of the children of Israel that day. But Caleb stilled the people and said, let's not waste any time. Let's go up at once right now and possess it. And look at this, for we are well able to overcome it. Y'all gotta grab a hold to this. Even though there is a sect of people who are saying and testifying they're too big for us, they will outnumber us, they are greater than we are, Caleb has a testimony that says, if God gave me a promise and if God told us this land was ours, there is no point trying to deliberate whether or not we can handle them. We need to know that we can handle them. We are well able. Let's go right now. Let's move. Don't worry about it. If we fight, we're going to win. And the Bible says that, but the men that went up with him said, we are not able to go against his people, for they are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land, which they had searched out unto the children of Israel. And then the Bible talks about the fact that the hearts of the children of Israel began to melt. Now keep reading with me, because this is important. I need y'all to get Caleb's understanding, his mindset about the children of Israel versus the people of Canaan. Watch this. Look at verse number 9. Caleb is so enamored with the fact that they can go and conquer now. Look at Numbers 14, verse number 9. Caleb still is talking, and he says, "Don't rebel against the Lord." Y'all, I need y'all to grab a hold of this. The Lord has given you a promise. He's told you to conquer. He's told you to gain momentum. He's told you to keep moving. He's told you to keep pressing. He's told you to fight. And he told you, and remember, all of these things, these promises come with, "I am with you. You ain't got to worry about it. Nobody will be able to stand before you." And Caleb is saying, listen, verse 9, "Don't rebel against the Lord. Neither fear the people of the land." Listen to this. "For they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Don't fear them if the Lord is with us." Now, I need you to understand the testimony of Caleb. This is the reason why Caleb got the respect of Moses and the respect of the Lord. Caleb said, it doesn't matter if they're giants. They are bread for us. Watch this. We're going to go into the land and eat them alive. We're going to go and take this land, and nothing is going to stop us. So watch this. But the people bade that he be stoned, because he's talking with this confidence that does not align with what their eyes are seeing. Now, remember, I told you that there is a danger of making assessments with only your eyes. Hear me. When you know what God has told you, here we go. When you know what the Lord has spoken to you about your future, about your job, about your ministry, about your children, about your finances, about your health, you cannot let what your eyes see convince you to override the word of the Lord. Caleb said, what I saw does not deter me from what I heard. What I know is that God is with me. I feel the Holy Ghost. What I know is that the Lord is for me. What I know is that he's promised to give this land to me. What I know is that if I go, it's going to happen for me. He says, let's go and do it. I can't let my eyes convince me what God has said cannot occur. They are bread for us. But there are people who are still doubting, people who are still going against the word of the Lord. And ultimately, if you continue reading in Numbers chapter number 14, the Lord gets angry because there are these people who have convinced the vast majority of the leadership and the people who are older that their faith does not mean anything in the face of an enemy that is bigger and stronger than them. So here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, y'all gonna have to stay here. Y'all going to have to wander in this wilderness 1 year for every day that the spies were in the promised land. And that's how they ended up with 40 years in the wilderness in this cycle. But I need you to see what the Lord says to Caleb. Look at verse 24. Watch this. Look at verse 24. But my servant Caleb, watch this with me. My servant Caleb, because he had another spirit in him and has followed me fully, him will I bring into the land whereunto he went, and his seed shall possess it. Let me read that to you one more time. Caleb gets a direct promise from God in the face of people who have just heard that they're going to die in the wilderness. God says to Caleb, but not you, Caleb. As a matter of fact, not only will you not die in the wilderness, but I'm going to take you into the promise. I'm going to keep you alive. I just read that in the text. I'm going to keep you alive so you can possess. Okay, this is a good place for you to put something in the comment section. I need you to write down, God is keeping me alive so he can give me his promise. God is keeping me alive. He is sustaining you to ensure that you're alive when the promise manifests. I feel the Holy Ghost right there. I need you to grab a hold to the fact that there are some enemies that should have been able to take you out. There are some sicknesses that should have been able to take you out. There were some accidents that were supposed to take you out, but you had not reached your promise yet. So the Lord has been keeping you alive to ensure that you could possess what he told you you could have. It wasn't that the enemy wasn't strong. It wasn't that the disease wasn't supposed to be fatal. It's that there was a promise. I feel the Holy Ghost. There was a promise hanging over your head. And God said, because I gave you my word, and my word will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which I please, and it will prosper where I send it. I will keep you alive to ensure that you get what I promised you. Look at the word of the Lord. He said, Caleb, you didn't sway when you saw enemies that were bigger than you. You didn't get shaken when you saw giants. You didn't get shaken when you saw fenced in and walled cities. It didn't shake you. You got to understand. He said, what you saw didn't change your mind. And because your faith remained in the face of opposition, he says, I'm going to sustain you to ensure that you can get the promise. Now, you got to understand, Caleb now has a word from the Lord, but he has to outlive his family. He has to outlive his friends. He has to outlive, watch this, maybe somebody he was married to. He had to outlive all of these people only to get to the point where God could give him promise. Can I tell you, I need y'all to hear me. I need y'all to hear me. God is going to make you outlive some stuff. There are some things that are attached to your life that don't believe you can make it. There are some people who are attached to your life that don't believe you can hang in there. There are some ideologies that people are trying to seep into your consciousness. But the Lord says, I'm going to let you outlive all of it because there is a word over your life that I must bring to pass. There are promises. I feel the Holy Ghost. There are promises that God must give you. Now, let me back up one more time because I forgot to tell you where Caleb is from. Caleb is not just a believer. Caleb is of Judah. One more time. Y'all missed it. I'm going to give it to you one more time. Caleb is not just of the children of Israel, but Caleb is of Judah. I need you to understand that there is a certain level of power, of gravitas, of understanding that comes with people who not only know how to praise God, but can praise God while they're surviving. And that means that I gotta praise God in the cycle. I gotta praise God while things are not changing. I have to praise God while I'm overwhelmed. I have to praise God while people who I love are falling off. I gotta, y'all, okay. Okay, I need y'all to grab a hold to this. This is the call for the praisers and the worshipers to maintain in the face of loss. Can you handle it when things are being lost, knowing that the promise is still assured? Because whatever you lost was attached to doubt. Good God Almighty. If it fell off, it was because it didn't believe like you did. If it died, it's because it didn't believe like you. Like, oh, I wish I had a talk back church. God is sustaining you because you believed when nobody else would. Because you held on to the promise when other people were throwing in the towel. And Caleb was sustained by God. God kept him alive. I told you I could preach that by all by itself. God kept him alive. Now watch this. It means that God had to keep him while they were fighting Jericho. God had to keep them when they lost at Ai. God had to keep them when they fought for Gibeon. God had to keep them when they fought the Amorites. God had to keep him when all of these other things were happening all around them. God said, I never forgot my promise. I'll keep you sustained. You've been in multiple wars, but I'm going to keep you. You fought in the wilderness, but I'm going to keep you. You fought when you crossed over, but I'm going to keep. I need y'all to hear me. The Lord is telling you he is going to keep you until the promise is fulfilled. God is not finished. I feel the Holy Ghost right here in my belly. I'm trying to get y'all to understand that God is not finished with you. It got hard, but he's not finished. You had to fight, but he's not finished. You had to deal with some stuff, but he's not finished. You had some obstacles, but he's not finished with you. So here it is, when you look at the text, the Bible says that Caleb is talking to Joshua, and he says, Joshua, don't forget that I came over here with some promises hanging over my head. I feel the Holy Ghost. I walked, I followed after the glory. I got to this point. I have led campaigns of victory, and it's all been to bring me to this place. In other words, Caleb said, I saw this land when I came over the first time, and I chose it for myself 45 years. Okay, I need y'all to grab a hold to this. Caleb said, I saw this space 45 years ago, and I said, this is where I want to live. And he knew who was inhabiting the land. He said, this is where the sons of Anak live. Now, I need y'all to grab a hold to this. Thank you, Jesus. While his counterparts, the 10, were afraid of the giants that lived in that land, Caleb said, if giants live here, I can live here too. Okay, I need you to understand, whatever has been feeding the giants is what I want to eat on. Good God Almighty, whatever made them like that, I want to eat that same fruit. I want to eat out of the same land. I want to plant in those same fields. I want the land of the giants. Good God Almighty. Caleb said, this is what I want. He chose his land 45 years in advance. Hear me. And he's choosing not just land for him, but he's choosing land for Judah. Okay, y'all got to grab a hold to this. He chose land for the praisers, and he chose the land for the praisers to be the place where giants used to reside. Okay, I need y'all to understand, where the enemy used to reside is the place that God has called you to conquer. And Caleb says, this is the land that I want. So he held on to his promise. He fought with his brethren until there was some level of peace. Then he goes to Joshua and he says, now remember, I told you I wanted that land 45 years ago. I never forgot. I kept the picture in my mind. It's like for us when we log on and we see something and we save it in our search history because we want to be able to find it quickly so we can remind ourselves of what it looks like. You have to understand, Caleb had a mental picture of what that mountainous land looked like. And he says, this is what I want for myself, for my children, and for all of Judah. Give me this mountain. But look at this. He says, I had to wait to get here again. It took me 45 years to get to this place again. It took me 45 years of fighting, 45 years of hanging on, 45 years of dealing with doubt, 45 years of watching my friends and my family die, 45 years of watching doubt die. And here I am, and look at what he says. The wait did not change my mind. Good God Almighty. I wish I had a few people who would just holler that out and maybe put it in the comment section, that the wait didn't change my mind. It took me a while to get here, but the wait, I feel the Holy Ghost, did not change my mind. I had to deal with some tears. I had to deal with some pain. I had to deal with some disappointment, but the wait did not change my mind. I still want it. Good God Almighty. Somebody put that in the comment section. Say, I still want my promise. I still want what God promised me. I still want what God said I could have. The wait has not changed my mind. But look at his testimony. I gotta go. Look at his testimony. Not only did the wait not change his mind, but look at what he says. He says, time didn't abate my strength. My strength remains. I'm as strong today as I was when I saw it the first time. Good God Almighty. The strength that I have today is the same strength I had way back then. See, here's the thing. We have to understand that sometimes we don't maintain our strength while we're in the middle of a wait. That means, hear me, this is why you got to exercise in the spirit, because you can't let stress make your strength wane. Good God Almighty. You can't let the weight make your strength wane. You got to hold on and you got to maintain. You can't let the skirmishes of your past make your strength wane. He said, my strength is as strong as it was 45 years ago as it is right now. I fought to get here, but I maintain strength for this mountain. Good God Almighty. Yes, I fought to get here. Yes, I had to take out some enemies, but I kept some strength because I know I have to fight for what I claimed. Good God Almighty. Watch this. Look at his confession. He says in Numbers 13, we are well able. But he had to wait 45 years to get to the land, but look at what he says. We are still able. Okay, y'all got to grab hold of it. He maintained his confession for 45 years. It started as, we can do it. It ended with, I can still do it. I believed it was possible 45 years ago, but here I am in 85 and I know it's still possible. God, for every time I won in the last 5 years has been proof that God will give me victory in this moment. I can still do it. But watch this. Give me a mountain. I don't want a valley. I'm willing to fight uphill because God has already proven to me that I can win even when I'm at a disadvantage. Give me this mountain. I still want my inheritance. I still want my promise. I don't care what the confrontation says. I don't care what the commotion is. I don't care about contrary situations. It will not change my declaration. I still want this mountain. Okay, I gotta quit. Okay, here we go. He says, this land is my inheritance. It's what I've lived for. It's the promise that God said he would give me. Now, but that mountain, it's also called the city of Arba. Arba is the name of one of the Anakim. And Anakim literally was a giant in that land who fostered multiple children who were also giants. So watch this. Not only does Caleb say, give me the mountain, but he says, give me the city of Arba, or give me the city of the Anakim. Caleb understood that what he was choosing was to fight foes bigger than him. Okay, you got to understand. This is not David and a Goliath. Don't miss me. The reason why David of Judah could defeat a Goliath is because it was in his blood. Okay, y'all got to grab a hold of this. It's not just the spirit of the Lord and the anointing on David, but there was a history in his bloodline that said Judah fights giants. Good God Almighty. I feel the Holy Ghost in here. I need somebody to put that in the comment section. Somebody say, Judah fights giants. Your praise is designed to defeat something bigger than you. Good God Almighty. I'm trying to move. But I feel that thing in my spirit. Every time you give God praise, every time you shout out hallelujah, every time you lift up your voice and say, God, you're still worthy, there's a giant that starts to topple. Every time you dance in the spirit, there's a giant that starts to topple. Your praise is designed to defeat giants. Give me this mountain. This is what I want. I will not take anything but what I claimed. I will not compromise what he promised me. God didn't keep me alive for me to take less than what I want. Okay. Y'all won't talk back to me. God didn't let me live for me to take less than what I want. Good God Almighty. I need you to understand that this is a season. Do not compromise your promise. Good God Almighty. He says, I want the mountain where the Anakims live. I want the mountain where Arba lives. Give me this mountain. And look at his testimony. He says, the Lord has been with me, and I know the Lord will be with me. Okay, one more time. Don't miss this. Not only the reason why I'm here is because the Lord has been with me, but I'm not here about my testimony of the past. I'm here because of my faith in the future. It's the reason why I still have my strength is because the Lord is still with me. And because he is still with me, I can still do it. Good God Almighty. Somebody open up your mouth and say, I can still do it. I'm trying to control myself here. I can still do it. I can still win. I can still conquer. I can still take out the giants. I can still do it. I got my strength. I can still do it. I can still see it. I can still do it. Somebody open up your mouth and say, I can still. can still do it. Look at this. He says, God is still with me, and I will be able to drive them out because the Lord told me I could. Okay, y'all gotta grab hold of this. He says, I'm gonna drive them out because God told me I could. Some of y'all still didn't catch it. I'm going to give it to you one more time. The reason why you'll win this time is because God put it in you to do it. God told you, go put them out. Go and conquer. Go and take the land. Go and possess it. Okay, I gotta go. He says, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna drive them out. I can still do it because God told me I could. I can still do it because God has given me permission. And if God gives me permission, he gives me strength. The reason why my strength has not abated is not just because I've been exercising in the spirit realm. It's because God keeps infusing me with strength that gives me the ability to carry out what he promised me I was supposed to do. He says, watch this, verse 13. I gotta quit. And Joshua blessed him and gave to Caleb Hebron for an inheritance. Okay, so I need y'all to understand this. I gotta quit. Just play something soft because I'm trying to quit. Now listen to this. Leave me alone. I need you to see this. Joshua blessed him. Watch this. That word bless is the word barak. It means to bless, to praise, to salute, to congratulate, to benefit. Watch this. In other words, Joshua speaks a word of well wishes. I declare over you that what you ask for, God is going to give it to you. I declare over you that what you have prayed about, God is going to put it in your hands. I declare over you that your strength will not be weak. I declare over you that your children's strength will not be weak. I declare over you that the blessing of the Lord, the grace of God, the strength of the Holy Ghost is on your life. I declare over you that it's not too difficult. I declare over you that you can handle it. I declare over you that God is with you. I declare over you that you can handle it. You can still do it. Good God Almighty. I'm trying to get out of here. But I feel the word of the Lord just rising up in my belly. It's not too late. You can still handle it. You're not too old. The moment has not passed. It's still your opportunity. It's still your moment. You can still do it. To start flooding the comment section with what you can still do. I can have a whole Sunday. Riskutabaha, Shataman, no Sokabahaya, Risekabo, Rimanabaha, Sadiabaha. I can still conquer. I can still win. I can still save my children. I can still have the job. I can still do the business. I can still. You to understand that this is the hour where God is equipping you to move in the direction of your destiny. It's not too hard. It's not too difficult. You can still do it. Claim it for your children's children. I can still do it. Woo. Hey. Glory to God. Glory. I need this thing to get embedded in your spirit. I need you to know that when giants show up, that's when the praise is supposed to come out. When giants show up, that's when you use your praise as a weapon. Do it. It can still happen. You still got your strength. You are strong enough to handle it. Good God Almighty. You can still do it. So I speak the blessing of the Lord over your life. Despite what your eyes tell you, don't forget what your ears have heard. The promise of the Lord is sure. Good God Almighty. His promise is still good. And if his word is still good, I can still do it. Glory to God. The challenge for us in this hour is to understand that every time God gives you a promise, every promise is not for what happens immediately. There are some things that God promises you that is distinctly for your future. But I need you to understand that if God gave you a 10-year vision, he'll give you strength so that you can handle it 10 years from now. He will never promise you something that he then will rob you of the strength to obtain. But if God spoke it to you, you can still handle it. You can still do it. It's not too late. You still got power. You still got strength. You still have the ability. And most of all, you still have the Lord on your side. You can still do it. And this is why we bless the name of the Lord. Now listen, you might be listening to the sound of my voice, and you're saying to yourself, there's some things I'm missing. I heard this word and I believe it's for me. But I feel like there's some parts of my strength that are still a little weak. This is what the word of the Lord is saying to you. The Lord is saying to you in no uncertain terms, what you need from me is relationship. What you need from me is to connect with me. Your heart connected to mine. God says, I desire to be connected to you. Well, Lord, how do I do that? If we would just confess our sins and confess the Lord Jesus, believing that God raised Jesus Christ from the dead on the third day, we shall be saved. At the point of your confession, your salvation begins. If you wouldn't mind, just repeat after me. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me in your blood. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I believe your word that you died and you rose just for me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Be Lord of my life, and I'll serve you for the rest of my life. And just like that, I can welcome you into the family of God. Your journey has just